Gun Training with the Non-Aggression Principle, Volume 1. Basic Handgun and Rifle with Jared Waltz.
First rule of being alive is you own yourself.
A groundbreaking approach to firearms and self-defense training. Beautifully filmed and easy to understand instructions make this one a must-have. Gun Training with the Non-Aggression Principle, Volume 1. New DVD from Michael W. Dean. Available on Amazon.
Your house is your property.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another edition of the Seeds of Liberty podcast. This is episode 64. We are joined this week by our friend Jared Howe, otherwise known as Jerry One. He is filling in for Danilo and will most likely be next week as well because, well, Danilo just doesn't want to play with us at all anymore. He was supposed to be here this week. Last minute, no. Sick kid or something.
I'll leave him alone.
I'm just kidding. Sick child, of course, take precedence, so hopefully his son feels better. Especially because my kids are going to be really upset if he doesn't, because they're all psyched to go to his birthday party on Saturday. But anyway, so before we get started, as always, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT No Government License. This allows for reuse by anyone except governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org. So, Jared?
It's behind you. Like, I can see the BIPCOT thing behind you.
So, Jared, man, what's going on? How you been?
I'm living, man, in the process of a move like Dave was recently, I guess.
It's not fun. But,
no, dude, it's stressful.
I miss your little board behind you that had the little drawing on it. I miss that, so it's gone.
Yeah, that shit's already moved. Already over.
Yeah,
no, it was weird because we found a place and we kind of snagged it and... we didn't really mean to, but the guy was like, well, I'll give you half off right now. Take the first month. So I have, you know, long story short, I have two apartments for a month same time. So I'm just taking my time. Kind of piecemealing it out.
Yeah, that's kind of how I had a little while to move out of my house. So I took like about a month to like put all my stuff into storage, and unloading it was like two trips. It was boom. It was so easy.
So, dude, I've already made two trips, dude. I'm ready for it to be done.
I'm still not completely moved in. I'm still waiting for some new cabinets, so it's then I'll be kind of moved in.
Yeah, if we look real, real close, maybe at points throughout the video, we might even see some boxes full of stuff behind you, right?
There's nothing behind me. I don't know what you're talking about.
Right now, it looks like you just moved in because you don't have any furniture except your chair there. But yeah, moving's always a pain in the butt. Although the last time I moved, luckily it wasn't that bad because I only moved six blocks, and the house that I was renting was almost identical to the house I bought. So I was literally able to bring everything over and put it back almost in the exact same spot. And since it was only six blocks and I had a friend who was living with me part time, she was like renting a room sometimes from me. And we didn't bother even with a moving van. We just put everything in our car and either drove it over or other friends of ours walked stuff over because it was literally like six short blocks away.
It makes me think of that, you know, like the New Yorkers that never leave the city and they're like, you know, like I've been to a good amount of places, or at least what I would consider a good amount of places around the United States, and I've left the city, I've left where I was from, and there are people that like literally haven't left like a 20-mile radius in like their whole life.
Oh sure,
it's insane.
Yeah, well,
dude, I'm within a 20-mile radius of where I was born. Right now, it's actually the hospital I was born at. It's like two blocks from here.
Wow.
That's straight up.
Well,
I'm closer to now where my mother was born and raised than I was where I was raised. So,
technically I'm not that far from where I was born, although I was shipped out of here at a very young age and, you know, grew up in PA, but technically, yeah, I was born right down the block at the hospital. That's not too far from here. That's pretty funny. Now, as soon as you said, I was about to make fun of Jared, and I'm like, no, wait a minute. Actually, I'm only a few blocks away from the hospital I was born at right now.
Yeah, I mean, it's not the town I grew up in, but it was, you know, I'm from Maine, so.
Yeah,
honestly, it's like
nuts, isn't it? That there's like people, they never leave the city. Like they've never left the city.
Well, yeah.
Like they've only seen outside the city on like TV. Like that, I just can't. Like, I would rather die, I think.
Well, you also got the opposite of that too. Like people who've never left like the woods and the sticks.
Oh yeah. No, like I don't know which one is objectively better. I'm just saying, like, I can't imagine.
I don't think
neither. Yeah.
I don't.
Yeah. Exactly.
I don't think sectioning yourself off from the world in any aspect is. I don't want to say, you know, like, it's not healthy, but it definitely.
You get a different mindset when you live in a city, man. Well, I definitely do.
Well, no, I'm not saying that. I'm not comparing the two in that manner. I'm saying that whether you've sectioned yourself off from the city by living in the woods, or you're sectioned yourself off from the woods by living in the city, if you've never left either one of those places, I think they're equally as, not really bad, but, you know, we were talking before the show about perspective, and that right there limits somebody's perspective if they've never left the area. Like I said, doesn't matter which one it is.
I walked through Times Square once, and I was like, yeah, I could not live in New York. There's no way. Like, that would be as bad as prison to me.
I couldn't either. I live 45 minutes away from it. I try to avoid it at all costs because the city's not for me either.
Oh, this is it's really good that the internet exists, right? Because like Dave said, like people in the city, they only know what they know about the world and life outside of the city by what they see on TV traditionally. Same goes for the people out in the boondocks, out in the sticks, right? They only know of life, what's in the city. If they're constantly out in the sticks, you know what I mean? Like they don't leave the they only know about life from the city. And if they're relying on like a third party, like a media outlet to give them that, then they're basically at the mercy of that media outlet as far as perspective goes. As where if they're on the internet and they're talking to a bunch of different people, I think you were saying this just on your on the previous episode of Seeds, Jeremy, how you're talking to people all over the world on the internet, which is completely unfathomable. It would have been so expensive to do so, and not even
silly. It's nuts,
impossible to do so. What, even 50 years ago, right?
It would have cost a fortune, well, you know, back in the 90s.
Oh, that's what I was gonna say. I know it from my lifetime. I remember.
I do too. I'm not that old,
dude.
I'm not that young.
The town next to us, growing up, used to be long distance on the phone. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, like, exactly. No, yeah. I remember. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like 50 years ago, it's a huge jump for 50 years. But even like Dave said, 20 years, you know, 20, 25 years ago, we were still dealing with this stuff. And
I wonder how many people have never I wonder how many like kids these days you could set a rotary phone down and they'd know how to like dial even like their friend's number on it.
I wouldn't be able to do it because I don't even have phone numbers memorized at this point, right? So,
I know.
I would have my cell phone open, looking at the phone number, going.
No. I bet you do have a few phone numbers burned into your brain. I bet you have your first home phone number burned into your brain. And I bet you have your first girlfriend's either cell phone or home number burned into your brain.
I don't have that, but I do have my first home phone number burned into my brain.
Yep.
I used to. That finally dropped off a few years ago. I can't recall it anymore. For the longest time, I could. And, it, you know, I guess, I don't know, once you hit the 35-year plateau, I don't know, maybe it just falls away.
maybe, who knows?
But
yeah.
But I think what you're saying is true, though. To a certain extent, not even if they were given the number to, like, even if we gave you the number, Jared, you'd be able to use a rotary phone. Some kids might not. I think it depends, though, because, like, my kids, for instance, had toy rotary phones still, you know, only a couple of years ago. And now that they're learning numbers, I still have one of them, and I plan on using it to help teach, you know, just as a supplement to help teaching, you know, with their numbers and stuff. So they'll be able to do it. So any kid who has those toys still to play with would probably do it. But outside of that, yeah, I doubt, you know.
As far as to suggest that anybody with an IQ over 100 could probably figure it out without much explanation if they know what a phone number is and if they were told this is a phone, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And, if you just said it in front of them and with a phone number and you were like, figure it out.
Well,
how long it would take?
See, I would like to think that, but have you ever seen like those videos they do where they give like kids like from like, you know, 6 to like 12 years old, like old school video games and
stuff
to play with.
Watch a Mark Dice video. Mark Dice.
No, because those people are completely. Some of the he pulls some of the worst examples, of course, to make his videos look better, just like anybody else does in those situations. But like the videos they do, just like they've done a series with kids where they take these kids and they give them like the old school games, and you watch the kids like freak out of like they don't understand like,
well,
how do you use these.
Yeah, one of the things I saw recently about that with the old school games is that they're actually researchers found that even the original Super Mario Brothers, Mario 1, was more complex than the traveling salesman problem, which you think about like Common Core math and shit like that. Yeah. Totally dumbs down school, so kids don't get any of that logic and stuff like that, and logic on the fly like that, especially with something like Mario. So you're right, you put them down in front of like
programmed differently, man. I don't think the push or that school system worked on all these nerds like us, like where we were just like playing video games. No. Like, why am I at school when I could be at home playing video games? Like, I don't understand this.
I think
the way you're like maybe like 10 years kind of before what I'm talking about on this, but like me and I can't remember a time where I didn't have computers in my house.
That's true. I've been using computers since I was like 5 years old.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah,
MDOS and stuff. Like I've been using computers since I was five. Yeah, so there are like that are even worse now that are like, I don't know what life is without a cell phone. Like I'm like, what? Like I could live without a cell phone. I think there's people now that would probably die without their cell phone. They'd be like, I don't know. I don't know if life's worth it anymore.
I think there's a lot of people
that are completely depend on it for their money, right? So yeah, if they didn't have their cell phone, then they would probably die.
I would find ways around it, but a lack of a cell phone would be a huge inconvenience in my business, and it would
sure be, you're a thousand times more productive with a cell phone than without a cell phone.
Exactly. Yeah. But the thing with the schooling, what I was going to say is that I think what you're saying, Dave, is true to an extent, but like for somebody like me, I actually had to overcome a lot of this because, I mean, I was always told from a young age that I was, you know, very smart, and I got, you know, they kept making me take this stupid IQ test because they wanted to get me into like what they called the gifted program back then. But I still was still very good at their system because I got really, like, I actually got really good grades and stuff, which really isn't a very high mark for somebody because of the fact that just means you're really good at memorizing stuff that they wanted you to do. So I faked my way through some of it because I didn't care and I was bored, but on the whole, it still worked on me enough that it still took another almost decade after the fact for me to start going, hey, wait a minute, was that stuff I learned true or not? So, you know, I like to point myself as an example of somebody who,
I'm sorry to interrupt, but dude, if it was true, especially if they were telling you the truth about like history and stuff like that, I remember going to school, like I was born in 87. So like I grew up, I was going through like grade school in the 90s, right? Which that's around the time like Soviet Union fell, and all my textbooks in school were old, so old that they're all like Soviet Union this, Soviet Union that. I'm like, what the fuck is the Soviet Union? So like it went from like Soviet Union to Russia. Mm-hmm. Without even skipping a beat as far as school go. And it's like, what the hell happened? And it was like it didn't even happen. Like communism didn't even collapse. They didn't teach anybody that in school.
Oh yeah, no,
that wasn't even talked about. We just glaze over the fail of the falling of communism and socialism.
I don't understand why people can't grasp why like these socialist institutions.
Because robber barons, it's robber barons.
Oh, if we had private schools teaching capitalism to kids, that would be just the devil, right?
Well, we have
to have all these social institutions where all these welfare whores are on there living on the dole, teaching and preaching unwittingly or wittingly socialist rhetoric and slamming it into people's heads daily. Yet we're supposed to pay for it. Like, oh, hey, this is cool. I really, really want other people getting this idiot ideology slammed in their head on my behalf. That's really cool.
We're being accurate. It's not even us paying for it. What we're paying for is education.
The interest on the debt. Oh,
Yeah, like a long time ago. So it's like those kids are gonna have to pay for their own school, and they don't even get it. They think it's free, and then they're brainwashed into believing that they have a debt to society and that there's a social contract. How is that not child abuse? They're gonna experience cognitive dissonance for the rest of their life because of that. They're gonna go wait a minute, taxation theft, and then they'll be caught between doing the right thing and taxation being theft. And then they'll say, oh my God, everybody who I thought was good in my life wants me thrown in a cage for following my conscience. That's going to be pretty hard on a child throughout their entire life.
Yeah. It's a comply or die mentality of the statism breeds.
It's total child abuse.
Well, it's kind of hard to look at it any differently. I mean, I consider introducing and indoctrinating a child into a religion at that young of an age to be an abusive act as well. So yeah, and before any of our other listeners freak out, I'm not saying religion is abusive all the time, because I know it's voluntary. No. So I do have some of our Christian.
No, I'm saying. Well, I know what you're saying. You're saying the minute the kid says, "I don't want to go."
Well, no.
You don't force them. Well,
not even that. It's just that I think giving certain ideas to children before they're capable of logic and reason can be abusive, because you're setting them up to follow you without being able to make the choice. Because if you give certain information to children when they're not ready to process it quite yet, a lot of times they will say yes and go along with it because it's what mommy or daddy or grandma or grandpa is doing, and they want to make them happy. You know, that's a big reason.
It's
that
just survival tactics.
Well, and there's another element to it too. In with religion too, is there's always some like negative evil force where if you don't follow the religion, you fall victim to the negative evil force, and you're like eternally tormented and tortured with that. So I think you're right, Jeremy, to present that to a child and be like, if you don't believe in this because of this, you're going to be constantly, you're going to have eternal consequences. Then that is a psychological abuse, I think.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not, I mean, and again, just to clarify for anybody out there, because I know I've said this before, but like with my children in particular, I have no problem once they get a little older and they're able to exhibit, you know, the capability of using logic and reason to solve other problems in their lives, then by all means, go look at it, study it yourself, study it even more extensively than I have. And if you find it's something that you want to believe in, then there's nothing I can do about that. And I hold that for anybody. So I'm not saying that I'm chilling it from forever. It's just, I think before a certain age, yeah, it is kind of abusive, you know, because it's putting this undue pressure on children. And statism is the same way. And I know we've talked about this before, you know, the idea of making a child as young as, like, I can remember doing it in the first grade. So a child as young as six, seven years old, having them recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
Oh, dude, I knew you were going to
in front of the classroom that. When they don't, many of those children do not even know what all of those words mean separately, much less together in the order they are.
Throughout their entire lives, they don't figure out what most of those words mean. Yeah, no, you're totally right. And I was, my first year of school, I remember it explicitly, kindergarten, Pledge of Allegiance. I remember.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I can remember. It might have been kindergarten.
There is no option to refuse. You had to do that. That was not optional.
I remember I just stood there and did this. I'd sit there and just text on my phone at a certain point.
I didn't have a phone in school, Dave.
In kindergarten, dude? Dave's
not in kindergarten, in high school.
Motherfucker.
No, in high school, man.
We're talking about...
In kindergarten, I'm too ADD to say the pledge, so obviously I'm going to be sitting there just like, why in the world is that like that? And why is that dusty?
They don't even there. And they don't even present it. They don't even present it like patriotism or anything. They present it like, this is school, and this is part of school, and this is part of knowledge, and this is what we're teaching you. You know what I mean? Like, you get that. Like,
if you're gonna get a socialist education, wouldn't it make sense to pledge allegiance to the socialist institution that's given you that that education?
No, I mean it.
I mean, think of it just like they would think. Hey, we need these people to pledge allegiance to us forever if we're going to give them free everything.
And you think about it too, and you rip kids away from their parents at like the the most vulnerable times in their life when they're trying to form like secure bonds with people and like form an idea and like their perception and their mental model of the world. And then you take away their most secure bond and their parents and you replace it with the state, a pledge allegiance to the state in the United States of the States. You know what I mean? It's just,
and not to mention anything else, but it's so completely unnatural. Think about kids in the natural environment. Nowhere where, unless you're just by chance, are they around that many kids at that same age. That's not natural for that to happen. That's what we call chaos. Like, that's government trying to order things, and that's not realistic. And that doesn't teach an appropriate view of society, in my opinion. Like, no, it teaches this, no, you should only be able to communicate with people at your level. And that's why, you know, people like can't believe a 13-year-old can graduate college. It's just, oh my God, he must be super smart. Like, nah, he was probably trained and well-read and forced to learn very hard at a young age by some parents instead of being thrown into a socialist school.
Yeah, and being thrown into a random group of people with no standards whatsoever on who those people are, especially in a world where the vast majority of people hit their kids, dude, your kid's gonna start they're gonna imprint on those other kids who are abused, even if you don't abuse your own kids. So you throw a kid into a public school and they're around all these other kids who are abused. It's a bad time, man. And then you wonder where does this bullying come from? It comes from parents who are bullies. The same.
Here's another thing.
Don't just figure that shit out.
If people are religious, like especially like if you're a listener of this show and you're a Christian, and like your kids are in socialist schools, they're being taught a different religion. Socialism is a religion. Communism is a religion. Statism is a religion. And
which
so is.
I see these anarchists that say that. You see these anarchists that say that you have to give socialists a chance. It's just an idea. No, dude, it is a religion. It's a faith-based reasoning. It's anti-logic. It's literally a revolt against logic. There's so much empirical evidence against socialism that says when you interfere with the market, when you interfere with the choices of consenting individuals, when you remove the method by which consumer demand is weighted against supply prices, when you interfere with that, bad shit happens. So you get shortages, you get booms, you get busts, you get these market failures. And socialists, like fucking drug addicts, dude, they just want to fucking, it just wasn't enough market intervention. It's the market's fault. We need more market intervention. Oh. That is cultish superstition. It's worse than that. It's like I said, it's drug addiction. It's literally.
The socialists, it's like they look at society like a computer, like they can program it like a computer. And they just don't understand that's not how it works. It's chaos. This is what's happening. It's like it's anarchy is what happens. And then all these governments are trying to interfere with it. And it has a word I love that you use a lot, deleterious effects every time. Even like they look at the cobra effect. Every law creates a cobra effect.
When you look at like Austrian economics and stuff like that, the dudes like Mises and Rothbard, they talk about the psychological benefit of an economic good. And that's really what it's all about, right? So the idea that socialists, whether they be like these violent socialists who think they can seize the means of production, or these resource-based economy people who think that computers can do it all, the idea that some group of people or computers or centralized force can determine an individual's preference in real time better than an individual can is it's so hubristic. And it's fucking retarded, dude. You don't even know when you're gonna want to go to the bathroom, right? So how is a centralized computer gonna know how much toilet paper to produce?
We'll just fill out the survey, look, Jared, and then the government will know your average speed.
And look at Venezuela. They couldn't even produce enough toilet paper because they socialized the production of toilet paper. Yeah.
It's hilarious.
You need prices to express consumer demand in terms of supply, or else you get misallocation of resources, period.
Socialists are funny. They're hilarious, and we all laugh, right? We all go, ha ha, socialists are here. They're funny. Until, like, the violent ones take control, and they have all the guns that, like, the fascists had. and then they become like these more uber, like, angry, we've got to force everyone to be a socialist fascist almost. And well, I can almost this crazy problem. Like, look at Venezuela. Just look at what was his name?
Chavez.
Oh my God, Chavez. Yeah, violent as fuck, man. Well, he's violent.
Chavez was violent, but he also, but the reason he got away with so much was because there were, like in most state socialism situations, the first couple of years, there's usually some nice trends. They usually make wonderful things happen, and everybody goes, "See, look." Because what was it? There was that one of those idiot writers from Salon was getting called out left and right recently because of a piece he wrote back 3 years ago praising Chavez and all the wonderful things that had happened. It's like, and now look at Venezuela a short 3 years later.
I believe the term he used was Chavez's economic miracle.
Yes, yes, what that's it, the one. That's
what,
the one.
What it was is he divorced prices. Got rid of prices and or suppressed them and divorced consumer demand from the supply, and they consumed all of their resources.
And you know what's
fast.
So sad? You know what's so sad about the whole Venezuela situation? Okay, let's bar it.
Highest supply of oil in the world.
Yeah, let's pause any conspiracy theories that the United States tanked the Venezuelan economy to rout the Maduro administration. Okay, let's bar that. Okay, let's just bar.
I don't think we need the conspiracy theories to prove that.
All right. This is how bad socialism fucks your society. Okay, and I mean that word literally. It fucks your society. The answers that the Venezuelan civilians are asking right now and how to fix this is more government. We just have to get the right socialist in, the evil socialist we're in, okay? Their problem, their fix to their problem that has failed has been socialism, and they're doubling down again. The citizens are there calling for another democratic revolution, and all they're going to do is get another fucking idiot put up there that's going to fuck them like socialism, because socialism just breeds this idea that problems can only be solved by government. And that's why I hate socialism and communism so much.
It's any political.
It's a generational screw job.
Ideology. Any of the state versions of anything will always end up in that situation. And the Venezuela thing, I mean, they've been on a roller coaster ride for decades. They go up, they go down, they go up, they go down, but it's open. You're right.
I agree with that.
It's because, I mean, what Dave said, well, you're right. It's because they wanna make it better, but they just replace it with somebody else who's looks a little less bad to start off with, but will end up in the same place. I mean, it's the same thing we've talked about it before with what happened in Romania, the last country to execute their leader on public television, and they went because communism destroyed that country. And what did they do? Did they replace it with a free market? No. They started to, and then they reverted right back to where they were again. It's not full-blown communism anymore, I don't believe, but it's close enough.
It's like proto.
Well, yeah, but it's the same. But what happened in Venezuela, you know, is the same thing that
happened. It's like
happened.
We're a communist country as long as your capitalist activity doesn't threaten our state. Well, that's what those countries are in.
Dave said, you get all these people that think it's just the people in power are evil or something like that. And yeah, they are. Anybody who's drawn to a position of power like that, I mean, come on. Yeah. But it's not just that. You know what I mean? There's problems. Like I said, with trying to micromanage people's lives with the erroneous assumption that you know what's going to be best for them or you know what their preferences are going to be ahead of time. That's not going to happen. They're not going to get the psychological benefit that they would have got if they had made their own decisions for themselves. So it's always going to end in the misallocation of resources. It's always going to end like that. Dave's right. I think, and I know you have a point too, Jeremy. It all forms of statism are like that. It is cultish superstition. But in a way, I mean, this dedication to like this economic socialism as opposed to like this nationalist socialism, where you had the people on the right that they think that there has to be like state provision of defense and security. Even that scares me less than the people who think that there's inequality inherently baked into every fucking aspect of everything.
Everything is inherently racist. It's just racist, Jared. No. Everything is, your face is racist.
Well, they start from this false premise that equality is real, therefore all disparate outcomes are a result of prejudice.
Get it out of your head.
And that's And it's what leads people to think that the initiation of force against white people, against rich people, against anybody is justified. It's this baked in idea that they're the victims of something. They're doing well. They must have stole stuff from us. It's this whole idea. Hey, I was born after all these people. It's not fair that they homesteaded land.
You know what? If you're a socialist and you really want to screw the rich man, and I want you to listen real loud and clear if you're listening to this show by chance and you're a socialist. If you really want to screw the big man, stop using his money. Stop using his system. Just stop. Just walk away. Start your own little socialist revolution without using the state. Just go say, look, we're just done with them. All right.
One better than that. If you want to prove socialism,
if the rich people's money is worthless, then they're worthless.
Let's not conflate the state with the people with the money, right? So if you want to go prove that socialism is the more superior philosophy, why do you need to convince everybody to go along with you? I understand why anarchists need to, because anarchists are trying to not have force initiated against them. Socialists claim to not really care about that. So if you want to prove that socialism is better, and same challenge to the primitivists too, that want to prove that living in the woods is better. If you want to prove that shit, you're right. Stop using money. Stop engaging in the market. Stop doing all this shit and just go off and fucking do it.
Well, sure.
I will say this, and this does make me say that some socialists do have some consistency. There are a few socialist like podcasts and like web shows on YouTube and, you know, things like that. But they do not – there's not many, and they don't have high numbers. The capitalist, the ANCAP, the voluntarist, the libertarian stuff vastly blows these things out of the water, at least in America. And I know that it's these things are rising in Brazil and other places around. And I, you know, it's exciting to see this people realizing, hey, we need free markets. Like, that's what's the problem here.
Well, that's what I was trying to get to before, is that I think one of the larger problems is the blatant ignorance of people, you know, of economics. I mean, Jared, what you've been talking about this whole time, with preferences and everything, that people just don't recognize, or they think they can assume that they know what other people will want. But, you know, because most of these people who, at least the ones that I encounter, so I'll use my anecdotal evidence. So this is my observation. I'm not making any claim of any sort, but from what I encounter, you know, a lot of these people are the prototypical, you know, they mean well type people, because they see what they perceive to be injustice, and not the total crazy ones that you guys were talking about, the inequality everywhere, but there's a lot of
not the SJW radical.
That's what I'm getting at too. I mean, there are people out there that think that, I mean, they see what is a legitimate injustice, and they've just attributed it to something other than what the source is.
But that's what I'm saying. So like, these are the people that I encounter the most, and they may have some really twisted ideas about things, but for the most part, they see these problems, and they're like, they just assume government's the only way. But the reason they flock to socialism, despite the history that is there for everybody to see, is because they get swept up in this stupid euphemisms and the term changes, and they go, and then they, and people will point to,
I
stuff
think
like,
the linguicites attack their brains, yeah.
Yeah, but people will
point, and they get turned into like radical egalitarians, dude, is basically what it is. It's radical egalitarianism.
But they'll point,
you know, not one of these idiots.
They point to places like, you know, Scandinavia or what goes on in different countries that are succeeding. And just like Venezuela, who's ridden the highs and the lows, the reason they get to that point and the reason they're able to do these things is because of using markets beforehand. You know, anytime the boom bust cycle in any system, only the bust is only allowed to happen when the market's allowed to do when it's allowed to do what it's supposed to do. And that's allocate resources in the way that they're, you know, it, where they're the need no, the most, the, not where not where
exactly.
People want to put them. That, you know,
and then the bus are a good thing.
Oh, no, they're, I'm not saying thing. The bus, yeah, no, of media, course. The, oh, absolutely.
No, I know you're not. I know you're not. The media never says that, though, and nobody ever talks about that, right? So that people paint these buses like these things that have to be avoided, and that's what Keynesianism is all about. It's like, we gotta print the shit out of the money and find this sweet spot with inflation so we never encounter these busts. But what they're doing is they're decoupling prices with interest rates from the market, and they're making money too cheap, and it's leading to these booms and busts in every market
attempting to subvert supply and demand. That is what socialists and Keynesians do, and it fails because then they can't price things correctly.
Ooh, you're absolutely right. And if they just left it the fuck alone and they let the bus go, it would be like ripping a Band-Aid off. It would be really painful at first, and then, like Jeremy was saying, resources would get reallocated to where they needed to be and where they'd be used most efficiently. The people that are wasting them right now would go out of business and they'd have to find different jobs, and everything would be okay in a shorter amount of time. It's like when there were other recessions, right? Like even before the Great Depression, and I think at the early 20s, they had a recession where the government just didn't do anything, and it was over within a year and a half, 2 years, something like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
and here we are. We had the...
That was before Coolidge, I was just going to say, that was before Coolidge, actually. I think it was the changeover between him and
Harding.
Yeah, it was him and Harding. But that one is actually, by most even mainstream economists who are willing to discuss that, will even say that one was actually a full-blown depression. It just didn't last very long.
It was worse than the Great Depression.
Yeah, it would have been. Yeah, if the same tinkering had been done as has been done in the quote unquote Great Depression, then it would have lasted, and the Great Depression wouldn't have happened because it would have kept going. But because they stepped back and said, "Nope, it'll correct itself." Like you said, it was year and a half tops. The entire thing was done.
It hit hard. If realistically the Fed would just raise the rates, bite the bullet, raise the rates up, and just everyone kind of got shit on for about a good solid 6 to 8 months while the market corrected itself, the Fed could probably keep its existence going. But I don't see how, if it keeps printing money, it's going to exist any longer. It's just going to go belly up. When we look at these things realistically, it's going to go belly up just from printing itself to death and being too afraid politically to screw over Obama by raising the rates.
I think that's evidence why this whole next election's rigged, though. That's why I think Donald Trump's basically being handed it, because he's already he's like the dude that everybody loves to hate, right? So he's going to be that. I think, like I said, I think the election's rigged. I've always thought he's going to fucking win it. He could be that dude to get in there and be like, you know what? You're not getting your Social Security. You're not getting your welfare. You're not getting your food stamp
payouts.
We can't
pay for it, folks.
Yeah, no. Well, he let it slip. I know Jeremy made a couple of memes about this. After he let it slip, he started talking about how the United States would always be able to print its way out of debt. But Peter Schiff and Jeff Deist, actually, from the Mises Institute, both talked about his comments in depth. And he admitted that he was going to try to get holders of treasury bonds to renegotiate the debts, which is the opposite of printing cash, right? They're going to try to get them to accept less than 100 cents on the dollar. That's a default, man. That's the opposite of I guess you could keep printing cash, and that would be a soft default. But like I said, I think it's rigged, and I think he could be the guy to just be like, you know what, we're not paying out.
The Chinese economy has going through the same problem, and they're going to have to renegotiate their things. And if they do it, America's going to have to do it, because there's $500 trillion in debt, and then to who?
They've been stockpiling gold, though.
So the United States, on record, has the first gold, supposedly.
And China has the largest production base in the world. Do you know how the United States became the world's major superpower? By having the largest production base in the world. You know what's going to happen after this market correction? China's going to school the fuck out of everybody.
They're already well on their way. Because despite the fact that they still technically run a communist regime, they've loosened the reins in a lot of areas because they didn't have a choice because that's what I was talking about before with like Scandinavian stuff, where everybody points to that and says, oh, look at these wonderful miracles of socialism. No, they rose to that power on markets. Then they tried socialism, and they were actually smart about it for a while, which is why it was able to last for so long. But even those great countries eventually had to say, crap, we're now out of money. Because like you look at Denmark, Denmark's just a joke. Everybody loves the point of Denmark. The people below 35 are a-holes. They're lazy effers. They have no motivation whatsoever because we gave them everything, and now they don't want to work, and now there's no money because only the people that are over 40 are working.
They ate their seed crop.
Exactly. And China took a different route, but they had to make the same choice, because otherwise the entire system will collapse if you don't. Because you
know, China has allowed, you know, certain things in their economy to happen that were very not communist stay alive. And I think that's what you see is that step back from that complete, like, totalitarian communism to this, like, step back fascist communism where, like, the state, as long as the state has its hand in it, we don't really care what you do, you know? And that's kind of how it is in America. As long as you pay your regulations and do everything, we really don't care what you do.
I think what it is the state's a lagging indicator, right?
Oh, of course it always is.
Texas is a lagging indicator. Yep. So once they realize that something's failing, they have to pull back. You know what I mean? North Korea, they had the socialist price controls on food like Venezuela had, and what ended up ending that is people were starving to death, and the black market, people start growing their own food, which is exactly what I guess what the government's apparently telling people to do in Venezuela, which is what they should have been doing the whole fucking time instead of standing in line waiting
for
somebody
to
give them food.
One of Kim Jong-un's, the one that's in power now, one of the most radical things he did is he freed up the food market, I think, there, where he allowed a
private... He had to.
Yeah.
That was after the black market already took over.
Exactly.
They had no choice.
Capitalism wins even in the most hardcore of hardcore statism.
Of course, that's, you know, the other example is what happened in the Soviet Union, where the black market is what kept it alive. But that's also what, you know, if it wasn't for that, then everything would have crumbled. But they were forced to change because everything took over. And it's like, oh, well, we're already going this direction anyway. So... might as well hop on the bandwagon and say we're going to, you know, do it and just dissolve everything and say we're going to do it for good. But it happens everywhere because they don't have a choice, because otherwise they immediately get shown to be what they were the whole time. If they can play that game and hop on the bandwagon and make it seem to the less intelligent or the people that are paying less attention because they're already currently starving to death and they're only concerned with keeping themselves alive, so they're not seeing what the actual causes are. So when the government's able to sweep in after the fact and say, hey, look what we did. Now we're making things better because we're doing this. They can still keep that legitimacy. You know, it's the same thing that's happened here over and over and over again. Like all the idiots that talk about how, you know, we just want kids to go back to work in the mines. No, you idiots. Child labor was on the decline before government stepped in with their laws.
No. Yeah. No, the reason why child labor started going away is because of capitalism, excuse me, and creating labor-saving type of technology where people were able to be, you know, the providers in the family.
You're not going to let a kid run a forklift, you know?
Well, it's not even that. It's that technology made adult laborers so efficient that children didn't need to work. Yeah. That's what happened.
Yeah,
you know, here's another thing that really boils my blood with socialism is it's the labor theory of value in communism as well. The labor theory of value is such just bull crap, because someone mining gold and someone flipping burgers to feed people, they're not providing the same thing. They may be laboring differently and should be compensated for their labor differently, but their labor value shouldn't be static. And that's an idea that socialism breeds, that you can have these static labor prices, and it's so stupid. It really is.
Well, it's not even just that. It's the idea that a seller determines the value of their labor when they don't. It's the buyers that determine the value of labor. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, like if a seller... the buyer has all the control. So seller decides they want to get rid of something, they're going to get rid of it for as much as they can possibly get rid of it for, but it's ultimately up to the buyer whether or not they want to pay the asking price. And if they don't, then it's incumbent upon the seller to lower the price if they want to get rid of it. You know what I mean? Yeah. So it's but what socialists don't realize is they think they're being exploited. They think that consumers they approach consumers from the perspective that consumers are infantile children incapable of making decisions for themselves, when
exactly.
In reality consumers are in complete, all other things equal, consumers are in complete control of everything. If there's high demand for something, if there's profits for something, that's because of consumers. That's what's going to drive more producers into an industry to compete for the consumer's attention. And if the consumers go to something else, that's going to drive people into different industries and resources into different industries to compete for the consumer's attention, the consumer's dollar. The consumer controls everything in the market economy. And the socialists want to suppress the will of the consumer, want to institute price controls on things like labor All that shit. That's the degree to which they want to violate the consent of individual consumers. Not only consumers, but sellers too. And it's just the consumer that ends up paying the highest cost for all this shit.
Oh, it's man. Look at what price controls for energy does. Who ends just up, look at what that does for energy.
Look at any Section 8 drives up the average cost of rent in any city by like 20 to 30%, I think. Here in Lewiston, in Maine, I'm actually leaving Lewiston soon, but rents have gone up, I think, 10% year over year for like the last 4 or 5 years. The apartment that I got 3 years ago, whoever gets it next after me is going to be paying 30% more for it than I'm paying for it now.
That's out of control. Well, if people are willing to pay for it, then it's going to.
But that's what the market's like. But I'm not saying that taxation and regulation, code enforcement, I'm not saying none of that shit doesn't drive up the cost. But the fact that there's, and especially too, where I live in a city of 34,000 people where there's close to 7,000 refugees, and there's only so many rental spaces, you know what I mean? That's higher demand on a finite supply of housing. Prices have gone up, dude. People used to pay, I mean, average like 1 or 2 bedroom apartment in this area, and it's Maine. I know it sounds cheaper than a lot of places, like $400 or $500, right? Average 1 or 2 bedroom apartment now, it's between $700, $800, $900, sometimes even $1,100 if you want something that's nice that you want to guarantee that hasn't had bed bugs in it. Like state welfare, price controls, that shit absolutely ruins housing markets, especially rental markets. And you know what else is really bad for rental markets? The manipulation in the housing markets, dude. These manipulation of interest rates and the buying and selling of mortgages and just jacking up the prices on that shit. It's awful. You have all these people thinking they can flip fucking buildings, and then they charge, they'll buy like a 2 or 3, 4 unit building, and they charge the price of a mortgage each unit. Yep. You know what I mean? This Section 8, it's because of all these price controls. It's awful, absolutely awful for poor working class people. Absolutely awful.
Sure.
And yeah, what man. It is, well, it's these things,
that free money that the Fed's printing out.
Well, it's awful. Well,
yeah, that's what it is. It's, they're just trying to fix those problems. Sorry, go ahead, Jeremy.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, because it's not even just the poor working families. It's everybody now. Although, I guess technically half the time I'd be considered poor, because the line keeps going up. But because
you're in New York.
Yeah. Well, I'm in New York, but it doesn't matter.
All right. So to not receive the last one that I read, to not receive more from the state than you give them in New York, the state of New York, you have to give them $97,000 a year. You have to make that much money. You have to pay taxes on $97,000 a year income.
Yeah. It doesn't happen for me. So, I fall. Well, I guess. Yeah. Cause because of my situation with my kids, we qualify for everything. I just don't take any of it. But the fact of the matter is, it affects everybody who's not in that. I don't want to say the 1%, because worldwide I'm in the 1%. But you know, the actual people who are controlling things. Other than that, it starts to affect everybody. These ridiculous prices. I mean, there's people in my neighborhood that do make decent money and are still having problems. Like their house is still worth nothing compared to what it should be in a less regulated market. You know, I mean, the price would probably go down because of the getting rid of the regulations and all that other bullshit and the taxes. But, you know, adjusted for that, they'd still be screwed right now because the system has just completely obliterated whatever.
You know what it is? It's the value doesn't go up or down at all. The value for all these places stays the same, maybe marginally goes down over time, or goes up as people. And
it's this zombie economy, man.
Yeah, no, it's the prices that fluctuate. It's the value of the money that's changing. It's not the value of the houses that's
changing. Oh, yeah, that's what I meant.
And that's what makes things scary.
Yeah, but
I was trying to tell my parents that they just I don't think they got it,
dude. Every person, if you try to explain that to somebody, they have something vested in a mortgage like that with which they've had it or will have like 30 years invested in. You tell them, hey, you have a mortgage that you're going to end up paying $700,000 on that you probably got for like $150,000, something like that. If the housing market collapses, you think that your house right now might be worth a couple $100,000. If the housing market collapses, it might lose 80% of its value.
Yeah, it might be worth about 15.
Oh, yeah.
On a good
day. They don't want to hear that shit. They don't want to hear that shit. Oh. They would rather die than hear that shit. They would. They would fuck it. They will scream in your face, ignore you, not have relationships with you, change the subject. Anything they have to do to not hear that
change the subject
shit.
Is well, what happens at, every time I bring it up. Yeah,
but at this point, you would literally have to be completely blind to not be able to accept that as a possibility. Because heck, it wasn't even a decade ago.
When it should have happened in 2008.
Yeah, but it came close.
What happened to me in 2008. I bought a house in 2007, dude, and I got totally
me too.
Fucked.
Me too.
$150,000 mortgage. Hey, you know how much it went for an auction? $25,000.
Wow. Yeah. So you got hit even harder. I bought a house in 2007, and it took in 2008, and since then it hasn't recovered according to all their numbers. I took an $80,000 cut from what I paid for it. The appraisals and everything, $80,000 still hasn't recovered.
And people talk themselves into believing that they're safe from this shit, or even if it does happen, it's still a good investment because my credit will be good because I was making my payments. What the fuck is that even worth?
No,
if the fucking
if the system goes down, your credit means absolutely nothing, you idiots.
You know, and I keep telling them, you know, the minute that this happens, the banks are going to call you and they're going to say, hey, yo, Mr. or Mrs. blah, 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 you owe us $110,000 on this house. Do you have that? Are you able to pay that right now? If not, we're going to, like, need that. it's all legalese. Well, I guarantee you it's buried down in there.
As somebody who's been through a foreclosure, they're not that nice about it, and they're not that calm about it, and it's constant calls to your phone all the time, and it's harassment, and it's bad, and it's not something that I would wish on anybody. It's like going through tax problems, you know what I mean? It's those motherfuckers, dude. They know, too. They know that they were going to get bailed out. They all did. You know what I mean? They put people through the worst shit that you could kind of possibly put people through, ejecting them out of their houses. And a lot of them, you know, they got in there, myself included, on money that I really should have never been lent in the first place. I was a high-risk loan, dude. I got a mortgage when I was 19 years old. There's no way I should have got that money in the first place. But at the same time, dude, they responded to the incentives created by the states, but they also were lobbying. There was regulatory capture. They took advantage of it.
Sure.
Oh, so they could get the houses and then resell them at a bigger price.
Yep.
Yeah.
And that shit's gonna happen again. Like you guys were, dude, it hasn't even been 10 years. Here we are chilling in 2006.
This one's not the housing bubble. This is the dollar bubble. The dollar is the next bubble. I swear it is. Look, every time Peter Schiff and all these other guys say that this is a bubble, it happens. And you can only ignore those guys so many times. And the dollar is the next
bubble. Peter Schiff, I mean, how much effort like CNBC goes to try to like discredit Peter Schiff, but he was right about the housing bubble. He was right about the dot-com bubble. He has correctly applied Austrian economics to what's going on in the economy, and he understands the Keynesian perspective, so he's able to explain it exactly why Keynesians are wrong in their own terms. I think he is right. People go, oh, well, you've been calling for $3 gold for years and it hasn't happened. He's like, yeah, so what? I'm long on that. I've said that I've been long on that. I think he's right. I think when the dollar, and I've been saying that for years too, when the dollar peg collapses, all these dollars sitting in foreign reserves are going to come fucking crashing down on American shores really, really hard. You're going to see all that monetary inflation turn into price inflation, and people are going to be like,
it might happen soon. Saudi Arabia on state national television just said the United States did 9/11 for the premises of starting global war on terror. Like Saudi Arabia, that is literally an act of war. They're supposedly an ally.
Saudi Arabia 9/11. I gotta look this up, dude.
Yeah,
you don't believe me? Look it up, dude.
I'm not saying that I don't believe you. I hadn't heard about it yet either. So I guess.
So I don't know what's gonna happen soon, guys. They have $1 trillion of United States currency. $1 trillion. And if they go to essentially economic war with the United States, they're going to dump all that money before any kind of legal or any other kind of international talks happen. So $1 trillion gets dumped on America. If that happens, China's going to do it. China has $2.3 trillion in cash. So all that's coming back. So that right there is just $3.3 trillion coming back. That's just what we know about. That's probably not what will also come with those. So you have all that currency coming down on the United States within a month or so. A cup of coffee is going to be $10,000.
Sorry, did you just call a month timeline for the collapse of the dollar peg?
That's what it sounded like to me, but...
No.
I get what you're saying. I think what you're saying, if those things happen, it'll fall within a month or so. That I would agree with. Yeah.
If Saudi Arabia dumps $1 trillion, everyone else is going to dump their money.
Oh yeah, the first country to actually go through. But again, that to me would only be a real threat if the different state governments weren't actually working in together on some level. If everything was on the up and up, shall we say, and they were really just fighting against each other in this scenario, then yes. But we all know that the only reason this has survived so long is because they have to be colluding to some respect. Otherwise, it would have never lasted this long with the dollar being tied to the petrodollar.
I mean, look, Saudi Arabia is the world's largest oil exporter, and America is the world's largest oil user. So there's obviously been some collusion between those two countries for quite a long time.
Oh, no, but I'm just talking about in general. I don't know if it's all of them.
So much.
I mean, look at everyone around Saudi Arabia gets their ass bombed to shit, and Saudi Arabia is just there, just making money.
Yeah, I don't think it's so much collusion as I think it is like stalemate, Cold War type tactics. You know what I mean? I think people are scared. So I think we see the battles playing out in like the propaganda and currency war and stuff like that. You know what I mean? And then the war for resources, right? So people are fighting over the Middle East and stuff like that about the petrodollar. And it's not because it's not because America needs the petrodollar. It's not because America needs oil from there. It's because they want to prevent other people from having oil from there.
Yes.
Which is totally fucked. They want to make sure that everybody trades their oil for only dollars, which is like, it's keeping up Social Security and Medicare, because these politicians, people like Hillary Clinton, don't want to tell the people the truth that government's fucking broke and that their payments depend on their kids.
Well, of course.
So you want to get to some questions that we had in the old group today? We can maybe knock out a few. I think we thoroughly bash socialism well and thoroughly today. And I'm always down for that because I hate socialism.
All right. Well, if we're gonna go to those, I guess the first one that would be closely linked to what we were talking about would be the questions about Bitcoin, since that's an avenue we've discussed before about a way to avoid it altogether, but at least start shifting yourself away from this system and not have to worry about if and when the dollar collapses, you know, what will you do? Well, if you keep diversifying, including into cryptocurrencies, then you stand a much better chance of survival should the inevitable...
The most stable currency the last 4 years has been Bitcoin.
Well,
you know what? I'm long on Bitcoin too, especially as an indicator for what's happening in terms of like the currency markets. I think as people get increasingly concerned about what's happening with like the dollar and with your legacy banks and you're just your traditional currencies, I think you're going to see people start to have more faith in cryptocurrencies as well. And as more services and goods, as people start exchanging those directly for Bitcoin, you start seeing like hard metals being exchanged directly for Bitcoin. And I think that's also going to long term drive up the value. I think cryptocurrencies are more than likely definitely actually here to stay. And when a dollar crisis happens, it's going to be a good place to be.
Yeah, it's going to be exciting to see what happens, because if there's only 23 or however many million bitcoins in the world,
21 million, I think,
21 million in the world, right? And you have like, I don't know, 100 or so of these. You have like there's so many billion of people in the world. If you divide that out, you're going to be well over a millionaire in a Bitcoin economy. If you have 100 Bitcoin, you're going to be just, you know, you won't have to wipe your ass the rest of your life if you don't want to. And I don't think one cryptocurrency is going to rule the roost. I think Bitcoin might be like the gold standard of cryptocurrencies, but I think a lot of other cryptocurrencies are going to pop up that are competitors, and that's good. That's what money has needed for the longest, is to be you to be able to go, well, this currency sucking, let me instantly transform to this currency in three milliseconds.
Yeah, I mean, people think that there's flaws, maybe there are with Bitcoin, but I mean, the if there are, and say the currency failed because of it entirely, people would learn from those flaws, and with the next cryptocurrency and the next blockchain backed currency, that it would just be that much better. I don't think that the blockchain currencies or the cryptocurrencies aren't going anywhere in general. I think
it was either Forbes or Financial Times put out an article. It was like, central banks are in full panic mode because of the blockchain. Just the blockchain, not even Bitcoin. Just the blockchain.
Well, yeah, that.
Well, now they're fully researching it. Now they're trying to take advantage of it. Goldman Sachs came out and said we're gonna try to replace all of our notary and affidavit signing with blockchain signing. It's a fraction of the cost.
Well, yeah, and that right there ties back into what we were talking about earlier with the state and the corporations that are in bed with the state being a lagging indicator to these things. It's finally like, oops, I guess these people weren't kidding about this. Now we have to do something about it. So of course, and the government will be the next one. They're probably working on it right now too. They want to figure out how to use the blockchain to their advantage, because they realize exactly what you said. That technology is here to stay. Like the blockchain, I agree with you. I don't think it's going anywhere. And I also agree.
Well, you know how like email was back in the day, like when email first popped off. Like everybody was like, oh, email's kind of cool, but you know, I really don't see any real world application. And now like I can't imagine a world without email. Like essentially even like text messages are emails. Like,
oh, people didn't see real world applications of social media at first, dude.
Well, yeah.
You know what I mean?
So like we're just at that point right now with the blockchain, and that's what's crazy about the whole thing is we're just at like version 1.0 right now, essentially. Like wait till we're on Bitcoin version 10. It's going to be insane.
Well, yeah, but that's what I was saying. It's not. I mean, I agree that I don't think Bitcoin's necessarily going to be the one, and it's. I don't think anything is necessarily going to grow any further unless there's more competition. That you know, that's kind of needed in any market. Otherwise, it just you end up stagnating. So I think it's going to continue. And I mean, the original question we were asked was regarding the current rise of it. And I mean, I don't personally think it's tied to like a dollar, the impending dollar collapse or anything.
I can tell you why Bitcoin has risen in the last month or so. The main reason has been China.
Because more people are buying it.
Chinese people are Chinese people that know about Bitcoin are slowly dumping their yuan for the Bitcoin assets that they can get over there. And all the mining over there that's happening is because of all of the socialized power that happens over there. You know, if you want to start a Bitcoin mine in the United States, you're paying way higher price for your power than you are in China, where it's all subsidized and whatnot.
Well, it's already like you guys already said. It's simple. There's a finite supply of them. It's a known finite supply, and it's hype and it's enthusiasm, and the demand is not even close to peaking yet. So it
hasn't even leaked into popular culture yet.
Yep.
No, yeah, exactly. And you're starting to see it. I've seen actually, I think, a few rap songs specifically about Bitcoin with not stuff that I think you'd see on MTV or anything like that, but like fairly high budget videos, people that tried hard, you know what I mean, on put something out on YouTube. So I think it's kind of starting to leak out there. And I think that it's just going to accelerate at an accelerating pace. I think that it is when the demand starts to top off and it starts reaching that, what do you say, 22 million Bitcoin limit, you're going to see the value of that shoot right up. And in the long-term price of it will probably stabilize, especially in terms of gold. Once they start exchanging gold.
What Bitcoin, in my opinion, needs is a gold-backed currency to compare itself to. And there technically isn't one right now, because everyone that tries to do it gets destroyed by the United States military.
Well, yeah, so I don't think that's necessary for its survival.
I think that what it needs right now is something to compare itself, where I can go, okay, I can trade this many bitcoins for this much gold.
But you already have examples, and not necessarily in gold, but you do. Well, I mean, technically,
well,
you do.
The gold price off the dollar is not realistic.
Well, exactly. How else do you find it? You find it how you find any other value. What people are willing to take for it. That is what is becoming the value. People like us who are purchasing it and using it, we are helping create that, you know, we are helping shape what the value of it is in other people's eyes, because it's whatever people are willing to pay for, just like anything else. So I'm never too concerned with having any gold-backed currency, because that's
Well, there will be one in a free market.
I'm not saying that. I'm saying right now. I'm saying to have something to put it against, because it's all warped because of the state anyway. It doesn't matter. Any other state that tries to put up a gold-backed currency for any other reason is still going to be manipulating it for their own advantage anyway.
Well, yeah, because their treasury is going to set the exchange rate.
Exactly. So it's still not going
to. You both already brought up good points anyway, and if somebody tried to put up a gold-backed currency, they'd get annihilated. So that's the cool thing about Bitcoin. If you want to see hard monies and like a currency that can be redeemed for actual money, then you're going to need something like this that cannot be taken down as a segue to make that happen.
Exactly.
I think the reserve and the dollar collapses, people are going to flood into cryptocurrency, and then after that you're going to see a big time return to hard money, and then you'll have a mixed economy of cryptocurrency. You'll have a free market in currency, as there always should be. There should be free market money.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's the biggest problem in America. People blame everything on capitalism. If it was capitalism, then why is there socialism in the money supply?
Yeah. You can take your money out of that socialist supply by going through Coinbase.com and downloading their app and, I don't know, giving them some fiat money and getting Bitcoin.
Yes, you can.
Yeah.
So next question, sir.
All right. So I think we handled that. Well, the next question we have, I don't actually have an answer for, but it is an interesting topic. And I saw the article that that Donnie, who posted this question, was referring to. Why does the Federal Reserve have a private trading floor on the stock exchange? My answer is, why wouldn't they?
Yeah, that's what I said. You're shocked?
Right. The whole market exists as a spread over the Federal Reserve. So, yeah, why wouldn't they?
I know, but I think it was just the fact that they're actually like – this is becoming like public knowledge now, to the point where people are like going, oh – I guess maybe it was rolled out, so most people will go, well, of course, and then they won't think about it again. But yeah, of course, that's the only thing I could think of. Why wouldn't they? They help shape everything else. Why wouldn't they have their own?
Like, I don't know how people. It's like you went to one concentration camp after World War II, and you're like, how did this happen? And then you went to another one, you're like, oh my God, they're doing it here too, and then you just keep going. It's like no end. It's like, yeah, that's how shitty and bad the Fed is. Like, every time you learn about them, you're like, wow, they're doing this. This is so shitty. Like when you're like, wait a second, the Fed financed the Bolsheviks. Oh, they also financed the Maoist revolution. Oh, they also funded the Nazis. Oh, they, holy shit. It's like, well, when
why
does
do
this
you think
end?
Bernie Sanders, why do you think Bernie Sanders loves him so much? He didn't want to get rid of the Fed. When he was criticizing the Federal Reserve, it wasn't because he thought that they should go away. It's because he thought that they should print even more money, and that that they should make even more loans to even riskier people. He thought literally that the solution to the problem was more of what caused the problem. Socialist price controls in money markets.
You just got to break the dam, socialists, man. If you want it to flood, you got to break the dam. Just print it all. Just start. If Bernie got into presidency, he could just start printing trillion dollar bills and hand them to everybody, and everyone could buy all the shit they want, right?
Maybe he'll still have a chance, because it sounds like
we'd all be trillionaires, Jared.
He may be buying himself
a
cabinet.
Now. Fuck it.
He may be buying himself a cabinet position in Hillary Clinton's administration. I mean, he says that he's gonna do he looks forward to meeting with Hillary, actually, according to him, to beat Donald Trump.
He would love to be able to change the Democrat Party platform with his delegates, of course.
money well spent. People patting themselves on the back of this grassroots campaign that I think it almost kind of did what Ron Paul's campaign did. Anyway, but all that money now...
A lot more violent.
A lot more violent. A lot of that money now is going to be, from what it looks like to me, we'll have to
wait and see. I still think the convention is going to be crazy. I think the convention, the Democrat convention, is going to be insane.
You know what? I kind of have some like selfish, childish pleasure I'm going to get out of it. And again, I'm an anarchist. I'm not voting for anybody, but I'm kind of excited to see debates between Trump and Clinton. I just want to see him say something savage as fuck to her. I think that would be absolutely great.
He's going to be blowing you under the Oval Office. That's all he's got to say. And show's over. Ride him on in.
I'll, gonna do is be like, your husband raped women and you covered it up.
I've already said, if it gets down to the debate between Trump and Clinton, it's gonna be a joke. Trump is an ad hom. He is a troll master level 30 if he gets elected. He's only at 28 right now. He might go to 29 in these debates, but I think if Trump gets elected, he's a troll master level 30. And I have a ranking on trolls, all right? 1 to 30. It's only a few 30s.
Jeremy doesn't want to say anything positive about Trump at all.
I don't want to say anything. I don't want to say anything positive about either of them. And I don't honestly.
I drive down from Trump Tower to your house and whoop your ass.
I'm not gonna watch anything. But I honestly don't think the debates are gonna be all that. It's just gonna be theater.
Exactly. Oh yeah, it's totally theater.
But I don't think as much fun as it would be to see him pull that type of stuff out, like you were talking about, Jared. I don't see him doing it. I think it will.
I think he's doing it on Twitter, and it's not because I follow him on Twitter, but I do see the repost.
Did you see what he did to Jeb Bush?
No, I will maybe, but I did see, back
a few months ago. Like, he'll do the same thing to Hillary. He's going to just make fun of her. He doesn't even have to argue against her. All he has to do is make fun of her.
I see it come through my news feed, and he commented about the emails today. He was calling her a whale yesterday. I think there is going to be some entertaining theater that's going to go down. Is all I'm saying. And I want to see feminists get really upset about
Trump and Hillary's face. I'm already just tired of their faces. I'm just tired of it.
I mean, nobody's excited to see feminists get upset by this. I'm the only one.
So how do you guys see – all right, do you guys realistically see Gary Johnson getting that 15 and getting on the stage?
No, dude. D's nuts could pull fucking 10 or 15.
No.
You know what I mean?
All right, so like, Gary Johnson, if he gets on there, how do you think the debate's going to go? Do you think that Trump's going to try to play his whole game and Gary Johnson's going to try to play the Ron Paul game where you just talk to the crowd and ignore the idiots? I don't see how you win, actually. If you try to play Trump's game, you're going to lose.
Gary Johnson's not very quick on his feet at all, man. He's not.
We discussed that when we had James Weeks on, and I said the guy is not, I don't care about the debates. I'm not going to watch him whether Johnson gets in or not. I don't actually think he will, because I think another thing that was brought up in that episode, and exactly what you said, Jared, was what we were talking about, that D's nuts could pull more people before Gary Johnson could, because there was some inflated numbers that were thrown around a while back that has everybody thinking he's going to be able to do it. No, people who are quote unquote upset that have figured out that, well, the system sucks, but we still got to vote, and it's going to be a waste to do for a third party. So we still have to vote for one of these other two. So there's still way too many people out there like that, that I don't think anybody cares enough to actually say, well, even if it's for the wrong reasons, even if what they think Johnson's supposed to represent, because Johnson's full of shit. He's not a libertarian. The guy's a Republican.
I think a libertarian
I don't even know if I can call him a Republican, but he's like a Democrat convert Republican. Yeah, I mean, he tries to play this radical egalitarian shit, like, oh, the bake the cake thing and the burqa thing, you know what I mean? And how can you sit there and say that freedom of association doesn't include dissociation? Like, I mean, you're gonna force people to do business with each other if they don't want to, based on if they don't want to based on like sexual preference or religious. That means the government needs to be in a position to know what's going on in somebody else's head. So it means you literally
owns the business, Jared, because
it's also thought policing. So it's both of those things, right? It starts from the presumption that the government owns the business, and it starts from the presumption
does own the business. They do not have the owners of that business do not have the highest claim on how they operate and how their business runs. They do not own that. They are renting a license to do business from the state. That is all they're doing.
Yeah.
When you have a corporation, you do not own it. The state does.
I would say that there are a lot of firms that are in operation that are submitting to the theft and the death threat of having to do that. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the state legitimately owns anything, because you can't acquire an ownership right in something by threatening somebody or initiating force against them. So when you say that the state owns that, Alex, I understand what you're saying, but I don't accept that the state legitimately has a property right.
Just look at what happened during World War II to Budweiser.
The state claims to own it. That's what that would be the correct. I think that would be the correction in what you said. That would make it more accurate. Because
if you can seize it at any time, you own it. In my opinion,
no.
You can seize it at any time. You own it. And the rest of the population thinks that's just a justly seizure. Then yeah, that's gonna happen.
That's not how property rights work at all.
You do understand eminent domain, right?
Yeah, I totally do. I'm not saying that they don't.
You do know that
things.
We do not have property rights in the United States.
No, absolutely, that's not true. Just because property rights are violated does not mean that people don't have property rights. That's absolutely untrue. What you're saying, Dave, is that they're right. You're saying, you know what, states, the state, you're right. Might makes right. So you own this because you took it. You're basically saying there's rights.
I'm
you,
not saying
rights.
They're right. I'm saying
no. You are. You said. You're saying that they have
that's
possession of it. They have possession of it. They swipe it. They seize it. Nobody is arguing that point. We all have IQs over 100. I'm sure we all get that the state steals things. That's not the contention. The contention is, does theft or the ability to take something confer a legitimate property right? Does it confer a legitimate ownership?
Absolutely not. That's the basis of government, is that illegitimate property theft.
Okay. Yeah, so we gotta call things names. So when we say that the government owns the business,
we also have to call a corporation what a corporation is.
That's why I tried to correct you, Dave, and said claims to own it would be more accurate, but you wanted to keep arguing it against that, and now you're actually in agreement. So that was very confusing. And
okay. The state argument. Will come in and jack your business if they want it.
Because they claim to have ownership. It doesn't mean they have legitimate
ownership. And you can sit there and bitch all you want, and everybody else will go twiddly tatty too, and
you
sit there and watch it happen.
You sound like Kyle Wagner right now.
Oh, I don't know who that is.
That's an insult of the highest order.
I'm saying until businesses stop participating in the state, they can't sit there and claim they own the business. All you have to do is say, no, I'm not going to be a corporation, and no, I don't want to participate in this.
Like I said, nobody is claiming that statists won't initiate force against people for not getting business licenses. All we're saying is that does not confer a legitimate ownership right in a business.
I agree.
100%. I understand that you're playing devil's advocate, and I'm not saying, the statists think they own it. All I'm saying is that let's call things by their proper names. They don't own anything. The state steals from people.
No.
If you could legitimately own things by stealing people, if consent was the same as violating consent, then rape would be the same as consensual sex, theft would be the same as change. Yep. Let's not give them that point.
I think we got our wires crossed for a second, but we're in total agreement.
All right. Well, now that we're in total agreement on that, I'll move on to the last question we had before we
wrap
it up, I guess. Yeah. So the last question we had, which I actually probably should have led with, because this may actually have a little more depth to it as far as us answering it, but it was posed, how can a voluntarist live in the current society and still pay bills? And what I got, there was a little more to the question, but what I kind of got out of it is how best to adhere to your principles and still actually function in the current society.
Find something you'd love to do and do it and make money doing that. And, you know, the world, the reality is reality, and you can ignore it, and you can bitch about it, and you can complain about it, and you can sit here and say it shouldn't be like this, but that's how it is, and you either adapt or you die. So don't worry about how to feed yourself as a voluntarist or make money. Worry about how to do something that you enjoy and how to make money with it, and then the rest will fall. You'll be able to live the lifestyle you want after that.
I pay my bills by working a 9-to-5 job. And I stay true to my principles by initiating force against people.
Yeah, I think some people may, and I'm not saying this particular, the person who asked this particular question thinks this, but I think some people may think that it's impossible to have these principles and apply them to the current world. But as Jared just pointed out, and I think I can point out something similar, it is possible. Are you going to run up against things where you can't help but deal with coercion and the force of the state? Unfortunately, yes. But that's not you. Yeah, but that's not you initiating force.
That's why I don't understand these
Well, it's not immoral for you to have to deal with that or like submit to that. It's like, is it immoral to get raped? You know what I mean? Like, exactly. It's not. It sucks. It sucks. It absolutely sucks. But it doesn't mean that you're a bad person if you have to do something that you don't want to do to protect yourself.
Well, sure. Exactly. And that's where, like I said, that's where I think a lot of people go a little bit astray. They think that you, in order to be a voluntarist, in order to try to live this life right now, that you have to do everything voluntarily. Well, again, you can do everything voluntarily with other people, but there's certain things that are being forced on you. You can't avoid some of these things.
You just look at it differently, in my opinion. You look at it through a different lens. You know, the tax man and the state no longer is, just an inevitability or something, an apparatus, so you realize that it's just a belief. And then you, once you change your belief on it, where you don't believe in the state, nothing changes. You're just like, wow, there's a bunch of shitty people out there that don't realize that they're being shitty right now, or they do, and they're sociopathic, and they need to stop. So, I mean, that's about the only way to live as a voluntarist.
Well, I would say that you could also, I mean, to go off of what you said before about, you know, finding something that you love. I mean, that's a way that I encourage people to do it right now is try, like, I know it sounds easy. It sounds easier than it is when I say just try to start a business. But you know what? Find a way to do that. And it doesn't have, you don't have to go out and just, I've said this before on this show. You don't have to go out and just drop everything you're doing right now just to start, put all of your eggs in one basket and try to start a business.
No, man. Convince three people a year. Three people a week. I don't know. Set a goal. Convince somebody that taxation's theft.
Yeah, but
you know what I mean? Get people thinking. I mean, do something. I mean, you don't necessarily have, like you're saying, you don't have to change your whole lifestyle. You don't have to quit your job. If you're taking money for the state, if you're living from the state, stop it. Find a way to reduce your dependence on the state. You know what I mean? Minimize that shit. Like, work toward that shit. You know what I mean? Like, individual gradualism, if you have to, whatever. Fucking just encourage others, if you know them, if they're dependent on the state, to get off the state. Enable them to get off the state. If you know somebody who's in a bad situation because of the fact that they resisted the state where they were in the right for doing so, help them. Do whatever you can to help them. Help people out. Be a voice for people. Speak truth to power, dude. This, the only reason why people who are anti-state are marginalized is because they're separated and because they don't have a firm control on the media. And social media is so important. The internet is so important for getting around that.
Yeah,
it's the biggest weapon we have for the spreading of ideas, and it is ultimately what's going to be the state's downfall.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, just look what Seeds of Liberty has done with how many people we have, and, you know, and the idea of voluntarism is not a big idea. There's not many pages out there. There's not many websites. There's not many podcasts out there that are getting a ton of traction compared to, you know, a podcast about just the silliest thing ever, like a TV show or something that gets millions of downloads. You know, just one or two people putting a concerted effort towards anything can make change. They can change people's minds. They can make people laugh. They can do all kinds of things.
All of these things about trying to get the message out is important too. But, you know, to get back to the original question about, you know, how do you actually pay your bills right now and do that? You know, like what I was saying before about what Jared had pointed out about, you know, if you have to work work an actual job right now, then you do that. But you take steps towards getting yourself freer. You take steps towards possibly starting your own business. You know, that's something I encourage a lot of people to do, is, you know, to take off what Dave said originally about, you know, finding something you love and do it. I mean, that's something Jeffrey Tucker says, but it's true. You find something that there's something pretty much everybody can do out there. They just don't realize it, that can actually make you money. Everybody has either some talent or something they can make or some service they can provide that could actually translate into receiving value from somebody else in exchange for that. Most people just either assume they don't have it or don't think they have the time, but that's why you started on the side. You know, I've talked about this before. I'm kind of a rarity. I got very lucky. I stumbled into a business. It took off unexpectedly, and here I am 11 years later. I am not the prototype. But there's plenty of other people I know who started off just, they worked a 9-to-5 job, and then they took, instead of taking all of their free time and having fun or doing other fun things, but not necessarily productive things. They took some of that time out and allotted a certain amount of time every day to spending it on trying to start some other business. You know, it can get a little hectic if you're juggling too much, but you try to do a little bit here and a little bit there. And then, you know, especially now with things, you know, going back to what we were talking about with Bitcoin before, stuff like Open Bazaar right now is an awesome avenue for people who, number one, are already involved or want to get involved in Bitcoin and are also looking for some place to sell whatever it is they have to offer. You know, stuff like that's popping up. So you could start.
There's a lady in Venezuela that's using Bitcoin to provide counseling over Skype. So yeah, you can make money anywhere.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Exactly. So there's so many options out there for people to do it right now. And even if you have to start slow, or even if you've convinced yourself,
there's zero startup in that.
Well, yeah, but you've convinced yourself you have no skills, you have nothing to offer. Okay, you still want to help move towards this voluntary society. You still want to adhere to your principles. Then latch on to other people who do have projects involved in trying to eradicate the state and make the state become obsolete, and donate your time, energy and or money to them instead. Because with all the other stuff that I do that as well, because there's certain things that I know I can't possibly do, and there's other things that I've seen come along that I think are great ideas already, you know, stuff like Cell 411, any projects out there. I've hooked up with a bunch of people, and if I don't have anything to provide from like a knowledge aspect or, you know, directly involved in the project, then I'm more than happy to give whatever time I can in other, you know, in other avenues that they need, or throw them a little money if I can afford it. Because you know what? That's how we're going to get there, is working together voluntarily and showing other people how this is done and how it could be done on larger scales. So if everybody would just do that, and in conjunction with the stuff what Jared was talking about, you know, just make a goal of convincing three people a year or whatever. Yes, is it going to be a slow pace? But sure. But you know what? You have to start somewhere. So all you can do is, if you believe in these principles, and if you're a voluntarist, the only principle you really need to believe in is that all human interactions need to be voluntary. So you go out and make sure that every interaction that you initiate is voluntary to the best of your ability. And you try to surround yourself with other people who are willing to do the same. And then the people that aren't, you try to educate them. If they're not, if they don't want to be educated, then you move on. And if there's a way to get them away from your life in any aspect, then maybe you should consider doing that. If you're going to explain all this to them and they still look at you and go, no, I don't want to do things voluntarily, well, you're not a very good person then, and I'd rather not deal with you. So right? there are ways to do this. And like I said, it's not going to be a game changer for everybody. It's not going to happen right away. But I think there are steps that people can take right now to start living a more voluntary life and start vacating the state in as much as they possibly can. And then, you know, the less people that rely on it, like Jared was saying before, with getting off the dependency, they're going to have to start coming up with new tricks to try to get people to need it. And by that point, the people that have already started doing these other things will be smart enough to go, it's just another smokescreen. And they'll continue to lead their lives, and the state will just become more and more of an afterthought. That's what I think.
Absolutely.
I think that was all the actual questions we have. Because my question can't be answered because Danilo's not here. I'll have to yell at him. If I actually am able to do the show from Porkfest in a couple of weeks, I will yell at him. So before we get wrapped up.
I appreciate you coming on, Jared.
Yeah, man. Thanks for having me on, guys. Always a pleasure.
Oh, yeah, man. It's always good to have you on and have a chat. Yeah. You, I say, essentially look at as our fourth host anyway. So we plug you in when needed, and it's not like we miss a beat. So it's a great thing.
What I'm here for.
All right. So
I'll be back next week, too.
Yes. All right. So this has been the Seeds of Liberty podcast. All our information can be found at theseedsofliberty.com.
New website coming soon, I promise.
Yeah, Dave keeps saying that. We do. I can confirm that we do actually have somebody working on a site. So I've said it before, but at some point, hopefully in the next next month or so, we will finally have a site that does not look like it was designed by a 12-year-old back in the 90s on MySpace, and we will move into the new millennia. And like always, please, if you like what you see here, like, comment, share, and just help us spread the message as far as you possibly can. And
are you sick of government lackeys who say you didn't build that? Are you tired of elitists who think you need a government permission slip for everything?
That's about it.
Everything you do is an A to B conversation. The government should see their way out of it. Create true free markets by adopting the BIPCOT No Government License.
Peace.
The BIPCOT No Gov License allows use or modification of any product, service, or software except by governments or government agents. Go to BIPCOT.org. That's Bravo, India, Papa, Charlie, Oscar, Tango.org.